So welcome to the last day of the course. There are two sessions today, so one now and one at 11:30. So at the end of this lecture I will distribute some feedback forms, so please fill them in the break, and then you return them to me at the beginning of next lecture at 11:30. And remember, at 12:30 we have the valedictory session, okay? So there are a couple of topics I want to cover in these last two lectures, and then, you know, I'll try to open up so far as possible for comments, you know, and final questions next lot. So one is agent-based modeling, one is network science, okay? Mm-hmm. So we're going to get at least some general idea about this, and then we have a couple of papers on these topics which are not published yet. One is accepted, one is submitted. Conference and the journal. So if you want to know more, I think it's a good idea, you contact me, okay? And this is generally true for anything I taught or anything I'm doing. You might check that on my webpage. If you're interested in any publication or, you know, any detail, you let me know. I will be more than happy to share material with you. Normally the publications are available on my website. And definitely if you have access to IEEE Explorer, you should be able to access everything, but if you don't, you let me know, okay? So there is no problem. I will be more than happy to, again, discuss with you, and, you know, and I would also involve my colleagues in Dublin if need be, okay? So we saw yesterday actually a first example, say, of agent-based modeling, though it has its own history and literature in a sense. But you could say that cellular automata is part of this agent-based modeling philosophy, okay, to a large extent. So today we're going to see another application. So yesterday we saw an application to channel assignment in cellular networks. Today we're going to see how we can actually use it to model an Internet of Things network, okay? So this is also to touch upon a very important part of the 5G story, which is not just, you know, the mobile broadband and cellular communication business. It's a lot to do with new kind of traffic, so machine communicating, sensors, so this IoT thing, okay? So we're going to see that that part too. So going back to the basic concepts of ABM, of agent-based modeling, of course, the big component is the agents, right? It's already in the name of the technique, so it must be very important. So anything that can make a choice in a network is basically an agent. So it's a very general definition, okay? The agents are autonomous, so they have each their own goals and behaviors. So this might resemble game theory a bit for those of you that are familiar with that tool. So there are some, in fact, overlap. There is some overlap between the two fields, okay? The agents can be adaptive, it's very important, so they can react to the situation and the environment. And we can have some sort of nested agent definition where we have multiple levels of agents, okay? So just to give you an example, you could think of a communication network modeled with different levels of agents. So you could have, for example, an operator, okay, say Airtel, and then Airtel would have probably different kind of infrastructures, right? Now they are even talking about interworking with Wi-Fi, so they might own some Wi-Fi access points too. And then you would have within the say the specific radio access technology agent, you would have the different cells or access point agents, and you could even have other things like, you know, specific applications, okay, of your network, like agriculture, factory, and that could be another level. So in a sense, there is no limit to, you know, this hierarchy. It depends on, you know, how you want to model your network, but it's very flexible as a tool. Another thing you can do is to have agents that are very much of a reactive nature, so they just act based on, you know, what happens around them, and then they take an action. or they can actually have more like advanced capabilities like learning. They can basically change their set of rules depending on some fitness consideration. Okay, so they can even have a certain fixed set of rules, or they can change it. Okay, so there are different things you can do, and you can actually add a lot of complication to a lot of complexity to your model. So it is a tool which is very useful to test actually the emergence concept which we saw before in this course, because practically you can just change the set of rules by simulation, the set of rules available in at the agent, and then you see the final outcome, how it looks like. Okay, and then you can test a whole set of rules and a whole set of parameters, values, and you know, it's a very good tool to test a large space of possible rules, basically. As we know by now, we talk about emergence when the sum of individual actions leads to a collective action which is not, can't be completely explained based on the knowledge we have on the individual action, right? So the individual action is known, the global action we can observe, but the link is somewhat not trivial to find out. This is due mostly to nonlinear interactions, like we saw also that in a sense you don't talk about emergence and complexity if you have a very much linear increase in the output and the information exchange with the number of components in a system. If there is this linear increase, then we don't see anything strange, right? We would expect that in a sense. So we have to be not in that situation to talk about emergence. An example is the wetness of weather. Okay, this kind of, for example, weather properties and so on. You might know very well what happens in a certain area, but it's much more complicated to come up with a decent prediction at a larger scale. In fact, the weather forecast, they are reliable within a time limit and to some extent not completely, right? So, the weather can be one thing, this is the water. So basically you do get, you know, the specific molecules, you know, that together give rise to that property. But if you just observe the chemical structure of a molecule, well, it's difficult probably to guess that would lead right to seas and oceans. So there is a combination of effects. And weather is another example anyway. So it's like, you know, you have basically local changes in the pressure or temperature, and that leads to global phenomena. So the cycle is basically based on an operating space. Okay, you act, and you might generate signals to communicate with other agents. You impact the environment, and then you observe the changes in the environment, and then you process this information, and then again you act. So it's like, it resembles, for those of you that have worked on cognitive radio, to the cognitive cycle. Okay. And there might be more to this in the sense that you could actually change the set of actions available, the rules you apply based on the knowledge, or you could just pick within the rule set you have, depending on how complex is your agent. What can you observe, for example, things like, you know, the delay performance, interference landscape in a network. How do you process it? For example, a basic version of agent-based model in actions, it's a lookup table. Okay, you have a certain set of situations with an associated set of actions, and you just check in which entry of the table you are, and then you act. Or you could have learning. You could, for example, change this table, or you could, you know, let's say constrain your attention in the table to some region of the table depending on the extra knowledge you have. Okay, For example, if you observe that the channel is very good and you are, I'm making an example, maybe it's not so ABM in nature, but just to give you an idea, if you have a link adaptation system and you know that consistently your channel has experiences a very good quality, there is no need for you to bother considering lower modes, right? You can go right away into high modulation orders, for example. So I think when you are in a sense looking up in a table without any extra insight, then we normally don't talk about learning, just adaptation. But if this table somehow can change, or you could even have, you know, different tables depending on the situation and so on, then you talk about learning. And this learning should be informed by your experience from the past, right? What you learned. So the one famous model of ABM is called Boyd's, and it's basically representing things as birds, pseudo birds, say. And there are a few rules, okay, which I'm going to go through with you. Now, it's an interesting fact is that Boyd, it's actually how apparently bird is pronounced in New York. I've never been in New York, so I can't confirm that, but according, I mean, it appears so in the, you know, when you read about this model, and I have an American friend working with me on this stuff, and he said, yeah, that's the slang in New York. It's kind of weird to say Boyd's, to say birds, okay? Some of you might have been in New York, might confirm that, I don't know. But I have no reason to disbelieve that. Okay, so now the three rules that are basically underpinning this model are separation, alignment, and cohesion. So separation means that you steer as a bird, as an object, okay, don't think just as a bird, okay, it's an object, okay, and it kind of resembles the actions of a bird. So you steer to avoid crowding local flock mates. So you don't want clashes, right? Or you don't want to fly too close because that might be impairing the flight itself, right? You will want to align. So that means you will steer toward the average heading of the local flock mates. So there is a certain direction in the flock, and you will tend to align to that, right? And the other thing is not only you tend to align, but you also tend to, in a sense, keep the flock compact. So you will move towards the average of the local flock mates. So there is basically a center of mass, right? Body center, if you want, of the system, and you tend to stay close to that. Now, it's kind of contrasting, right, set of actions, because you do have, if you get too close, you separate, but if you get too far, you basically align, right? So it's, and that's very much, I think, the way the, you know, a bank of fish or a flock of birds or a herd of sheep, you know, they would all tend to adopt this. So if you observe this, you know, how animals move in flocks or, you know, herds and so on, they will probably do similar stuff. Okay, they are not so advanced in communication and intelligence that there is, you know, in a sense, a very complicated set of rules to follow, and there is nobody in charge, in a sense. So that they will adopt very similar rules. So again, we are kind of trying to copy the good ideas of nature, you know, as in a lot of the work we do in complex systems. You can add more complex rules, though. You could, for example, have obstacle avoidance rules, or, you know, you could seek certain goal, reaching a certain destination, and so on. And it could be combining the two. For example, imagine you have a flock of birds, or of boids at this point, you can say, moving through a city, and they have to cross the city. But of course, there are skyscrapers, tall buildings, things, you know, like buses and so on. So the flock of birds should be able to avoid that. And they don't always fly very high. They can fly, right? So again, nature is pretty good at adjusting its behavior based on the environment. There is no multiple level in the original model, so what I told you before about like nested subagents is not here, but you know, there are refinements of agent-based modeling that allow that. So how about telecommunications? Why do we care? We can model network entities as agents. For example, an agent could just be the different parts of the of a transmission system, like could be end devices, like the phones, base stations, can be even fixed part of the network, core units. You might be able to actually examine the overhead necessary for coordination. You can actually integrate non-telecom elements. For example, we've seen an instance of this with the road traffic management network. Okay, so you can actually integrate physical events, like varying probabilities of traffic generation. You might have a very congested, you know, road traffic situation or a very light road traffic situation. It's very flexible to integrate basically heterogeneous kind of systems where you have a communication network, which is not the main objective of the communication, but is meant to be supporting another network, right? That's what you do with smart cities, for example. So what we found is that ABM is a good tool to do that. It's much less trivial to simulate these networks with the traditional tools we use. So if you are used to simulate telecom networks and you have to implement, say, a traffic management, I mean a road traffic management, I first of all, I bet you never did it. Second, it's probably not the best idea to use the tools you've been using so far, like NS3 or any MATLAB customized simulator or, you know, other things. So my experience tells me that probably you need approaches that are like this. I think they're much more flexible, and they have a level of abstraction which helps you, okay, to simulate this kind of systems. Yeah, and as we said, it is a good tool to, it's actually meant to capture emergence. So again, if you want to study these aspects in a telecom network even, it might be a better idea to use ABM, because it's a tool which is native in terms of having emergence embedded in it, okay? So it's meant to study that. So it's very good, you know, to study these emergent properties. Okay, that we saw already. So our IoT network is a traffic management network in this example. It's very simple. Okay, it's not a very complicated scenario. You have a few intersections. We also do some simplifying assumptions in the sense it's for the sake of simplicity, but you know the model can be extended without many troubles to more general situations. But what we assume, for example, is that the car is just moving in a straight line. So they stop at the red light, and then when the light is green, they move ahead, so they don't turn, okay, left or right. But you know, you could change your model to do that. So you know, sometimes you have some limited time to complete the work. So this was based on a master project. So you know, we had to finish the work by sometime, and probably next year we might have we might do some work to extend it. Another thing I want to say, this is not nothing to do with a specific scenario. Okay, it's good to integrate the communication aspect with another IoT-like aspect, for example, but it could be any other sort of strange network you can think of. We were even thinking in the beginning about an automatic system to irrigate golf courts. You can do that. Okay, there is no problem. Now, why golf? Because it's a big thing in Ireland. Okay, there are many good golf courts, but we picked this. Okay, but again, I don't think it matters too much. Okay, you can easily model the system, no matter what it is. Okay. So that's really how it looks like. So in the interface, so you have a few things. Okay, so you have a road, of course. These black dots are the sensors. So these are the guys basically sensing whether a car is waiting. Maybe it's stopped at some position because, you know, it's in the queue to the light, or maybe it's stopped at the light, or maybe it's just moving, okay, and then the sensors would have to report basically the number of cars waiting, and that will lead to some decision in terms of the coloring of the lights, right? If there is too long a queue on a certain direction, it's probably time to you know, make it green, and maybe you have to put red somewhere else. That's how a traffic light system works, right? You cannot have a green light in a certain street and a red one on another one forever. You will have to alternate these two depending on the traffic situation, right? Now, in fairness, I'm not a traffic management expert, but I do believe very little of the sensing capabilities are used today, if none at all. So they probably have some, you know, some statistical understanding of the traffic movement. They might even have some integrated information, but I definitely don't think current traffic management systems are IoT based. I mean, at least I'm not aware of it in Europe. Might be in some, experimental setup in some cities. They might be trying something, but it's, I don't think it's widespread. Definitely, okay. So these yellow squares are the cars, and this blue square is the decision maker. So this is the guy deciding, based on the feedback from the sensors, how to color the lights. Now, in this example I'm showing here, we don't assume the coordination between decision makers for different intersections. We will assume different intersections, but the decision makers don't coordinate. We have an extension of this work, which we are going to submit to a journal soon, where we do have the coordinated case too. So you can have a lot of different strategies, and it's relatively easy to change the code to simulate these kind of networks, okay? Of course, you have to rely on abstraction. This is probably not the best tool ever to model things at the physical layer, I would imagine. But you know, to have a simplified Mac and system level studies is pretty okay. And in my experience, you can change a lot of parameters, change a lot of setups. It was very easy to go from the case of one intersection to two intersections. It was very easy to go from uncoordinated to coordinated, not complicated to have different Mac protocols. We even have in this case, I'm not going to show that, but in the coordinated case, you have two layers of Mac. So you have the Mac for the sensor transmission within an intersection, then you have a higher level Mac coordinating the different decision makers. So you basically allocate the resources between the different intersections. So you can have heavy traffic, low traffic. You can really do many, many things without much effort. Okay, so this is the work of a master student. So, you know, if you're a PhD student or a postdoc, you can definitely do a lot of very, very good things with this. And my experience is that within a reasonable time, few months, you're really up and running. Okay. I can't say the same for other tools we use. I mean, if you have to do this with NS3, don't even start to think about that, okay? It's a bad idea. MATLAB is good for, in a sense, customized situations, you know, small systems and so on. If you start to go system level in a telecom system, it starts to be arguable whether it's a good idea to use MATLAB. And definitely, I never heard of people using those tools to implement this kind of hybrid networks, where you have a network of a telecom nature and then a network of another different nature. ABM has been used before for these sort of things, and it works. Okay, so my suggestion is, if you're interested in modeling IoT networks, it might be worth looking into this, based on my experience at least. So the block diagram is simple, okay, so the cars move. You can create new cars with some probability, and that's what defines the traffic. So if the probability of generating new cars is high, the traffic will be congested. If the probability of generating new cars is low, the traffic will be light, right? The sensors will basically collect information and it will tell to the decision maker whether the cars are waiting, because that's what matters in terms, right? If the traffic is flowing, there is nothing you have to do. If the cars start to stop, then you know you might have to take some action, right? And the decision maker will then act based on this. Now, it's not all simple as it sounds, because as you know, wireless communication is broadcast in nature, right? You transmit everywhere, therefore you can interfere with your neighbor's sensors, and it could even be the case that different intersections have some overlap, right? It's not that, I mean, you transmit and then the transmission sinks at the intersection limit and then the new one starts, right? There are interference problems, and so we have to come up with a decent MAC model, okay? So we tried different things. We tried TDMA, a simple Aloha, and CSMA at the uncoordinated level. Then we tried other things at the coordinated level. I'm not going to talk about that. We do model the system as a finite state machine. So there are a few states. So there is a state where all the lights are red. There is a state where the lights in a certain street are green only. And then the other state where the other street has green lights. And then there are some waiting times in between. Basically, between the time you go from a situation where a certain street has green lights to the situation where the other street has green lights, you have to allow the cars currently going to empty the street, right? So you don't want crashes. So, as happens in, and that's in a sense, these waiting things, the waiting cycles would be your yellow light, right? That's why you have yellow lights. You have to allow the traffic to empty the intersection before the other cars are allowed to go, right? You can change this anyway, okay? You can have more realistic models. As I said, we don't allow cars to turn, which is not realistic. And you could have, you can definitely change all these values, no problem. And you can even have more states where you might have possibly only one traffic light active at a time. This is, again, not a big deal, okay? Our idea was just, to pick something simple that works. Yeah, as I said, you can extend to multiple intersections, no big deal. Any questions so far or comments? Please feel free, okay? And we tested a few things, okay? So we tested spectrum utilization. Now, by spectrum utilization, we mean spectrum opportunities. So if you have five sensors, you would say the maximum amount of opportunities is five. So that's our spectrum in a sense. And then if only, say, two sensors out of five can successfully transmit, the utilization would be 40% in that case, two out of five. That's the way we define it. And you see, for example, that TDMA is insensitive to the neighbor radius. So neighbor radius means you increase the probability of collisions with other sensors, right? So you basically increasing this radius, it means that more and more sensors will be within the same coverage region. Therefore, they interfere with each other if they use the same channel. And you see that TDMA doesn't matter, because TDMA in a sense is it's sort of round robin. So you decide in advance who is going to transmit when. So there is no chance of collision if you do things properly. The only chance of collision is with other intersections, right? But again, how likely is it really that this is going to happen? Probably not so high. Okay. Now I'm trying to remember. These two intersection models, so there might be some collisions, but it's unlikely. Okay, there is really to be two sensors in two different intersections which are close and they are given the same slot. It's unlikely. Okay, and it's completely impossible if you have a coordinated system. The TDMA will work it out, right? Will never give if you have a coordination between the two intersections. That's not going to happen. But even in the uncoordinated case, it's unlikely. Other techniques like slotted Aloha actually get worse in terms of successful transmissions with the radius, okay? And same goes with CSMA. Now the difference between slotted Aloha and CSMA, you might know or might not know. Slotted Aloha, basically you try to transmit regardless of what's going on, and then if you collide, you stop, okay, you back off. The CSMA does the same thing, but it senses before. So it minimizes the probability of having a clash. But if you clash, you still back off. So the difference between Aloha and CSMA is that CSMA has an added sensing in the beginning. It's what they call carrier sensing, right? Yeah.
These results are out of simulation.
Yes. Yeah, we didn't investigate that. I think what I can tell you, though, like the complexity, but what the computational complexity, what I can tell you, it didn't look.
What I mean by complexity is the number of rules that you have, or
yes,
complex decision making that you
have. Yeah, not so many. I mean, basically, you do have to decide the
emergence is going to be captured in this also.
Yeah, I mean, these are. Like these are global properties, right? So these are like, you know, that's the emergent part, right? So you get.
For emerging systems, how do you define, like, how do I do my simulations? What's the size of simulation?
Yeah, I mean, you mean how many agents have to interact so that you get an emergent property?
Interactions should happen, or what's
yeah.
the order of time? Because
yeah.
you are trying to analyze the system, trying to know the system.
Yes.
And you don't know beforehand that these things are going to happen.
No. No, and there are some results that are not so intuitive, in fact, that we got. So it might be that, you know, you have to improve. So, for example, in the vehicle waiting time, it looks that no matter what we do, for example, you know, in the high traffic situation, doesn't really matter, you know, the protocol. So if you want to act on that, you might have to do something else. So you might have to add something to the rule. We didn't, you know, we didn't fully understand what to do in that case. But, I mean, the network we are using has 80 sensors, tops. Okay, so it's 20 per intersection. Considering all the possible interactions, starts to be quite a bit. So, in my experience, you don't need millions. Okay, you're probably okay with few tens. Okay, and I think that's enough normally to get the system working. Okay. Because there are many interactions. Interactions are, in a sense, exponential, right? So even with 80, you have quite a bit of possible, you know, inter-node, right, communication. In the study on network science, which is a bit different tool, but it's still based on this emerging philosophy, in that case, we have a base station deployment from Dublin, and I think we have about 500 nodes. Let me see if I can find it out. Should be able. Yeah, we have about 500 nodes. So these are reasonable numbers. I think, you know, if you think about, the example I'm going to show later today, not with ABM, but with statistical mechanics, it's taken from a real deployment in Dublin of base stations. So it's about, I think, a few square kilometers, okay? And this is reasonable. I mean, if you have a certain portion of the street, to have 20 sensors might mean that you have a sensor every 10, 20 meters. I mean, cars tend to move fairly fast, right? So you don't need a sensor every meter or so. Okay, you do run, you know, a few iterations. Okay, I'm just trying to see if I have the information. So basically, for example, in this case, we have we just run a certain amount of simulation, so this is 10,000 steps, and then you have to allocate what we call ticks. So within a step, you will have these time slots. Okay. I don't think there is a specific requirement at least that we devised. You could always have, I mean, the normal approach is that you fix the time or you fix the precision and then you run enough, right? That I think applies here too. But they're not too heavy as simulations. And another thing we notice is that it doesn't go up very quickly complexity. So if you go from 1 to 2 to 4 intersection, in terms of implementation or simulation time, it wasn't crazy. So it doesn't go exponentially, definitely. So it might be actually linear. So that's good news, because, you know, if you start to have, if you want to go beyond a simple four intersection case and say you want to model, you want to have an IoT-enabled city traffic management, you will have hundreds of intersections, right? So it's important also how it scales. So it's not so complicated. So now the situation basically with Aloha and CSMA is that increasing the radius of interaction, you do increase collisions. And these systems are, in a sense, best effort, right? They're not like TDMA, where you schedule in advance, so you won't collide. Here you can collide, and in fact you do. So the spectrum utilization decreases with the radius, but CSMA does a better job because it does sensing in the beginning. So there is this extra step, right, which prevents some loss. And that's why CSMA is the one working best. In an intersection, yes. Within an intersection, yes. In the uncoordinated case between intersections, they could reuse the thing. It's just unlikely that neighboring nodes will collide. But in the coordinated case, not even that. Okay, so yeah, you do assume either within an intersection or within the full system that you want to allocate the same slot to neighboring nodes ever. Okay. It's kind of round robin in a sense. Now, the curative information basically tells you the difference between how many cars you think, I mean, you as you know, the decision maker, you think are waiting, and how many are actually waiting. Okay? So it's like the perceived situation minus the actual situation. So a positive error would be a situation where you overestimate the number of waiting cars. Yeah, a negative error would be a situation where you underestimate the number of waiting cars. Okay.
So this sensors that try to collect information from the cars and they feed it back to the decision maker.
Yes. Yes. So the only information they tell is whether a car is waiting or not in that position.
So
the decision maker will give will tell the sensor in which slot to transmit.
Okay.
So the TDMA, let's say the MAC part here is the sensors transmitting to the DM. There is a higher MAC between the DMs when we coordinate. Right, higher level, yes. Okay, so basically you see here that again TDMA is not doesn't have any error, right? Because there is no possible mistake. You have mistakes when you have collisions. Now, all the information comes from the sensors transmitting. So if the sensors don't collide, assuming, you know, the communication link is okay, we are not going into PHY, we assume coding and so on is there, so you won't have mistakes, then TDMA should never have problem, right? But the other two, of course, they do have a problem, and they do behave a bit differently. For example, CSMA always senses, so it's always kind of overly cautious in a sense, right? You never become reckless with CSMA, quite the opposite. So at some point, you might simply be overestimating the number of cars, okay? Another thing you have to consider is that when you sense, you have to back off. And then you try again. The problem is cars move, right? And at some point the traffic light will change. So you might feed back information that is stale at some point, right? Because you say, okay, I'm sensing cars stop, but cars actually have moved because you are just retransmitting the thing, right? And Aloha quite the opposite, because it keeps trying even if it shouldn't, okay? Because it doesn't have a sensing capability. It's kind of dual in a sense. We also try to, we also basically quantify the waiting time of the cars. This is how much time cars spend in the queue. So either waiting at the traffic light or waiting behind cars waiting at the traffic light, so stopped, right, in the system. And first of all, when the traffic is high, doesn't matter what you do in terms of MAC, and that's not so surprising because if the traffic is high, the system is, pardon my English, screwed up anyway, right? So you are in a situation that there's simply too many cars, and you know, this kind of, there are bottlenecks everywhere, right? So whether you do a smart Mac or a dumb Mac won't change too much, right? Okay, the sensors will keep saying, stop, 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 stop. What do you do? I mean, you know, there is not so much you can do. In the light one, again, we see that TDMA does a good job, but marginally. Okay, it's not that they, I mean, this is probably what, 15% improvement, not, so we were a bit surprised to see actually that the Mac doesn't impact too much the waiting time. So this one case where possibly you should expand your set of rules, right? What Suvra was saying before, like, the Mac is very much important for things like how accurate is the information and how efficient you are in transmitting or using the spectrum available. But apparently, the one thing that doesn't depend on the Mac is the waiting time of the cars, which in a sense is the main point of an IoT network managing the road traffic, right? So there's work to do. I agree with that. And, you know, the possibly there are other things that should be taken into account. I suppose maybe delay-sensitive protocols. I don't know. Okay, we didn't really think it through too much, but that's just to say that, you know, it's not that the set of rules will do all the job in all possible aspects. Of course, you have also to, you know, customize your set of rules depending on what you want to achieve. So if your goal is vehicular waiting time, what we saw, there is something beyond Mac, or at least you need different Macs than what we considered here. Okay, any question or comment?
What about the efficiency of these basic protocols, Aloha, Spotted Aloha, and CSMA? Has that been taken into account?
Yeah, I think, you know, when we do the spectrum utilization, in a sense, so this is the number let's say, transmission opportunities available which you can catch. So TDMA, in a sense, is inefficient in nature, because, you know, it will never allow in a certain area different nodes to transmit, right? Even if they don't interfere each other. So they, you basically allocate, in a sense, the slots in a TDMA fashion, okay? I think CSMA is the best one in a sense, because it does allow nodes that don't disturb each other to transmit in the same area. And it does also prevent collisions to some extent by doing sensing. So what we could see is that at least among the three, CSMA CA is the best. Might be others, okay, you can test. We didn't test, you know, also because the nodes are simple, we didn't test multi-carrier systems, right? Multiple axis and frequency. You could have machines which are high rate and more complicated, so you could have also that dimension, or even MIMO to that extent. But you know, we think it's unreasonable to have many sensors deployed in the street that are very capable, okay? But you could, for example, have smartphones doing that, why not, right? So I think you can do many things, okay? But we just took a basic case of transmission over time, okay? Of access over time. But you can do many things, actually. Yeah, definitely. I mean, this is very basic. I mean, this is like the Mac work I normally do in comm networks don't use these things. Okay, this is like fairly basic. We don't consider multi-antenna. We don't consider frequency dimension. We don't consider power allocation.
What's the main objective of this? I mean, trying to analyze the
model it. That's the first objective. Yes.
Technology.
So what has happened in the literature is that ABM has been using few fields to a limited extent in communication network, and the best example I have, they studied at the policy level the secondary uses of spectrum.
And then the other question comes to your mind is, how do you verify your results?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think, you know, that there are some intuition behind this that confirms what we know of CSMA, okay, of this. So I mean, we do have explanations, you know, this makes sense and so on. I think as usual, this is a model which I think is difficult. I mean, models, for example, you could compare with, I'm not too sure though how useful that would be, that are similar in nature are game theory. So you could have a game theoretical model for these networks and see what happens. That is a possibility. And they might lead to different results. You could get a higher or lower efficiency. We didn't do that. Another way you can try this is to have a testbed implementation and see, right, how the model boils down in terms of actual performance. So, but the way we validated, in a sense, was to, you know, we kind of understand how these algorithms work, so they're very well known. So, you know, whether the results made sense in that respect, yeah. But that's the first time, to my knowledge, that ABM has been used to model an IoT network. Okay, that's again might be works. So we weren't aware of that at the time we published this. So it is a flexible tool, and my final message about this lecture is that, you know, it's a tool you should consider if you want to model IoT networks. And you should possibly, I mean, some of you at least should look into IoT networks in the next few years, because it's going to be a very big part of the 5G market and the research. So I think one take-home message from my course should be that you have to work also on this kind of networks. It's not allowed anymore that you just stick to the traditional cellular broadband, mobile broadband situation. That was okay for 4G. I don't think it's okay for 5G that everybody works on that. If not, you cut yourself off from a lot of the discussion. Actually, I can tell you that a lot of the funding schemes in Europe, interests of companies, startups, are in the space of IoT rather than mobile. Mobile broadband is going on. There is work to do, of course, but it looks to me, at the very least, is becoming comparable, the interest and the amount of work, and it might be even overcoming mobile broadband IoT at some point. So it's good to keep more than an eye on that. Okay, so at least some of you should work on that, and you don't need to change the tools or, you know, the knowledge, because as you see, many of the things we use are traditional communication protocols or techniques, but you have to apply them to a new scenario. So it's not acceptable if in 3 years, 4 years, I talk with all of you and you all tell me you're working on massive MIMO waveforms and you know, MAC for wireless networks. That's fine. Some of you should do that, but not all of you. It's important that you open up to these new applications. Any question or comment? Okay, so any comment? I mean, we have the feedback. lecture of the course. So my plan is basically to give you a quick idea about the field of network science and how we've tried to apply it to our networks. That's another aspect of complex systems which we've been investigating. And then I would like to have the last 15-20 minutes to open some debate, and you know, we can have a chat together. You know, regardless of the formal feedback form which you filled out, that's fine. But I would like to hear from you, you know, what you thought and, you know, your what you learned, what you didn't learn, and how you know, you're possibly going to apply this. If you have any idea for new research, I would be very interested to hear your voice. So you've been hearing my voice enough, so I would like to hear yours now, okay? So let's try to do it maybe 20-25 minutes. I'll tell you something about network science, and then 20-25 minutes we'll have a chat. All the material is, you have it. I mentioned a few papers. One paper I didn't mention because it's under review, but I can share with you a publication we have in a journal called Statistical Mechanics and its Applications about this network science business. I can recommend resources, so you let me know, okay? So in essence, what network science plans to do is to study, as the name says, networks. It builds upon graph theory, but it's in a sense different because it studies real networks, not necessarily just, you know, this abstract collection of vertices and edges as graph theory does, but it kind of uses many tools from graph theory too. So there are things like yeast protein to protein interaction network, or say road traffic networks, airport connection networks. If you look at them, I mean, they all look very similar to each other, you know, at least at a high level. So there's a collaboration network of physicists, so people within the domain of physics that collaborate with each other. The internet is on the right side here. Again, you know, just a zoom in of the like a road system in the United States, and then how the different airports in US are connected. This is another representation of the internet. This is, let's say again, internet at router level. So my only point with this quick overview of networks, if you look at them without the label, they all kind of look alike. So there is something, you know, that tells us that these structures are not that different in the end. So some questions you can ask yourself when you have this representation of a network, we are going back, by the way, to define network a bit more formally, is whether they display some sort of symmetry, regularity. Remember what we said before about complex systems. We are always chasing patterns. We are looking for patterns here, for regularity. If there is no regularity, there is no pattern, there is nothing we can learn and improve upon, right? A completely chaotic system, a completely random system, sorry, not much we can do. A completely regular system, again, not very interesting once you identify the template, but the real interest is when you have patterns that are actually not immediately obvious, and that's probably where the interesting bit is, okay? Again, you can use network science to study emergence. So all the tools, in a sense, that we deal with in complex system science are around the central theme of emergence. Either how you model it, you understand it, you embed it, but all of it has to do with this, okay? So if you really have to boil down complex systems in to one word, it's emergence, definitely. So this is another tool, basically, that can help you to understand how the networks are structured, possibly how they evolve, and if a certain behavior emerges out of local interactions. What we are interested in, really, as engineers especially, is to predict outcomes and to make statements about the health of the system. Health can be stability, for example. Is if the network is in a good state and we disrupt like some part of the network, is it still going to be okay? Or maybe does it become like a disconnected network where you have islands of connectivity, and then maybe some parts of the network don't talk together? Can you exploit the way the communication is, the way the information is spread through a network to actually to your advantage? I'm going back to this. So if you identify that there are some preferential paths of transmission of information, because of the structure of the network, it might be a very good idea to use them for your own sake, right? That's where you move from network science to network engineering, in a sense, okay? Now, the important distinction is between networks that we call exponential, networks that we call scale-free. So the way you can characterize it, and scale-free networks, by the way, are more interesting for us, okay? They are normally associated to the complex system science field. These networks are normally not. So an exponential network simply means that if you measure the number of connections a node has, and then you plot it as a probability mass function, you get a Poisson distribution. Okay, so it's like a bell-shaped thing, and after certain amount of connections, the probability is basically negligible, right? So it gets very small quickly. A power law distribution, which is actually associated with a scale-free network, is basically telling you that no matter the number of connections you consider, the probability is always going to be at least big enough. It can be small, but it will never become so small that you have to neglect it altogether, that you can neglect it altogether. So this is like more the situation we have with Gaussian, for example, and so on, right? After a certain range, and we know more or less which range, we can just say, okay, nothing is very likely to happen there. But you don't have this luxury with power laws distribution. It's called power law, by the way, because if you plot it in the linear scale, this is a power function, which becomes a line in logarithmic scale. Okay, that's the reason of the name. Scale-free is because no matter the scale at which you look the interaction, it will keep having the same behavior. Scale-free, it's independent of the scale. Many actually networks in nature and even man-made networks show this kind of property. For example, internet was shown to be scale-free. Okay. Okay, just some initial facts, and then what is a network? A network is just a collection of entities that are related by links. Links can be of different nature as do entities. So for example, you could have people that are friends, you could have computers that are interconnected, proteins that interact, web pages that point at each other, like the Google search engine is based on this concept, right? It will give you first top of the list of your search outcomes, the pages that are pointed at by the highest number of other pages, right? So that's how Google works. Now, they are all different, of course, when we talk about a road system, an air traffic system, a protein, interaction system, and internet, they are all very, very different, right? But they all show some commonalities to some extent. So normally, the formation of these large networks is distributed, bottom up, sort of looks like organic, okay, like a life system. You do have some different levels of structure. You do have individuals, but then you have groups. You have overall properties, right? Normally, the way these networks are run, or at least they work, is very decentralized. And you could actually study, you could basically use also these tools to study some strategic behavior. For example, this emergent behavior, is it always good? If you have a bottom-up situation, you have to rely on the goodness of people, of the components, okay? The tragedies of the common, it's a paradigm to say what happens if you don't share common resources properly. For example, we are all fishing in the sea. Well, I mean, many people are fishing in the sea, many nations. But if you don't do it properly, you might lead to overfishing, and therefore no fish left. Or water is not belonging to a person or the other, belongs to humanity. So if I go, I'm too reckless about transporting oil via sea, could be that at some point it becomes too polluted, and you know, all the planet is going to suffer because of that. So this is what we call traces of the common. So the bottom-up approach, it's powerful, but it's not necessarily working fine. Okay, it depends on, again, the rules and the interaction you embed, right? So for example, that's why you have, going back to the example of the sea, right, and the navigation and so on, you do have international treaties, right? It's not that India can do whatever she wants all over the seas, and she can't even do it in her own seas, right? Because that is going to impact. So there are some common rules that have to be agreed, okay? Now, network science is an emerging field. It hasn't been there for more than probably 10 years, more or less. But it does go back quite a bit, as we see in time, because it lays its foundation on graph theory. The main goal of network science is to examine the similarities between human and technological systems and organizations. So there are some things, no matter the network, that look alike. So this, you know, when you have the power of a predictive model is higher if it can adapt to many more different situations, right, than if it's just customized for one thing. So network science is a science in that sense, because it tries to come up with models that are of a general applicability. For example, things that we might be interested in studying is, you know, how things are connected, how they interact, how you can spread things in a network. And that could be seen as a positive thing or as a negative thing, like a countermeasure. So a positive thing, for example, if you know that the network is spreading information in some way, you should exploit it to your own advantage. For example, if you have to provide control information or broadcast information to everybody in the network, or you have to make sure some minimum level of performance is reached all over the network, then you should be able to exploit how the network conveys information. Also on the negative side, if you know that the network works that way, you can counteract more effectively bad guys, right? Now, there are some people working on security in this room, they might understand what I'm saying. So it's not just the good guys that will benefit of it, also the bad guys would, right? If they know that the network is very efficient in transmitting information using, for example, a certain concatenation of nodes, that's where you should be careful as if you take a security approach, right? That's where you should be particularly careful. Okay, so now one thing also is important to notice is that there has been quite some work done on the structure of networks. So networks saying, taken as a certain picture in time, a snapshot, there has been much less work on the dynamics of networks, how networks evolve into something else. So we are fairly good at understanding networks if we take a photograph in time, a certain picture of the network. We are less good, much less good, to actually understand how the network would evolve in time. And that's a big part, for example, of engineering a network. Because it's no good for me if I can operate the network very well in a short time or understand the network perfectly in a short time, I have no clue what will happen in a few minutes, right? That's something that is not really good for engineers. So historically, there has been not much interaction between communication and control communities, even less in terms of nonlinear dynamics like complex systems normally have. So I think it's high time, as I said probably more than once in this course, that engineers from the communication community talk and work with engineers from control community. We keep talking about adaptivity, cognition, feedback, and loops, and so on and so forth, and we never talk once with communication, with control guys. That doesn't make sense to me, because those guys exactly do that. Now, there might be a catch in the sense that those guys normally assume linear systems. We many times in this kind of new networks and so on, maybe linearity is just an approximation, but it's not really that these systems are linear, dynamical linear systems. So you do need maybe new tools like from chaos theory and stuff like this to study these nonlinear dynamics. But you know, my main point here is no matter the tool, you should start to have a serious tractation of dynamics. Okay? Very little papers tell you what happens to the network in terms of the time evolution. They will all tell you with some assumption, correlation might be there or not. You take snapshots, you average out. Problem is, if you do that, you completely give up on understanding the evolution, the actual evolution of the network. You will have a statistical understanding, which is okay, but you will not have the actual behavior, right? Understanding. So it's also important to know how your system evolves to a certain state. It's fine on average, it works that way. Game theory tells you, for example, it will reach that equilibrium, that's all okay. But we have very little understanding how you get there. And if your system is evolving in a very irregular way, that might be very bad. Or maybe your system is very stable, which is okay. But we normally don't know, or at least I'm not aware that people are very interested in that. And that's, it's time to change this approach, okay? So, and you get knowledge where knowledge is strong. You don't get knowledge from random places. So you have to, this can only come by a tight interdisciplinary cooperation with the control community. Otherwise, you will do something, but you know, you have to get the knowledge where it's strong. Okay, that's important. Yeah, there are a few approaches. Okay, I want just to leave some time for discussion in the end, so I'm not going through all the slides in very high detail. But there are approaches to network science that definitely have to do a lot with graph theory. We are going, for example, to see the concept of small world in a second. Some approaches are more, so from mathematics, say, some approaches are more from physics. So we did some work applying statistical mechanics to communication network. There is some work to do with AI, data mining, and so on. Statistics, inferential modeling, for example, this collaborative filtering, that's what they use for recommendation systems in the internet. So when you buy a book, say, on Amazon, then anytime you're online, they might send you emails or even, you know, banners online, or definitely when you go to Amazon again, they would tell you, you're probably also interested in this. And to some extent, they get it, right? It makes sense, the algorithm. So that's what they use for that. Yeah, these weak and strong ties. So there are, if you have a weak tie, between systems, it might be easy to lose the connection between different parts of the network. Okay. On the other hand, if you have a strong tie, a lot of information will be going through that tie, and then that's where probably you would attack if you were a hacker, or that's where you would send your information if you wanted to spread information quicker. So That applies, by the way, not only to social networks, it applies to networks in general. So it's very important to understand how the information moves through the network. So the US National Research Council defines network science as the study of network representations of physical, biological, and social phenomena leading to predictive models of these phenomena. So they don't mention technological here. I think that's probably a bit outdated as a definition, because there is a lot of work going on in some work in ICT. So, but the point is, you want representation of the networks leading to predictive models. So if you just understand the thing, it's not enough. You also want to kind of have a tool telling you how the network is going to look like, okay? Either how information is going to be transferred in this network, or possibly even how the network itself will evolve. Will there be new nodes joining? Will there be nodes leaving? Will there be new cluster formation? These kind of things, okay? And you can immediately picture how this could be relevant to our networks, right? Because there is a lot to do with new deployments, and of course, how we transfer information is all we do, okay? So there is definitely a very big scope for applying network science to our networks. So the starting point of network science goes back to the starting point of graph theory, and graph theory basically started historically by a problem that Leonhard Euler formulated in 1736, so we go back about 300 years, and that actually led to a new field. Okay, so the problem is intuitive in its formulation. So there is a city actually. It was called Königsberg. I think I have the name somewhere. Yes, so now it's called Kaliningrad. So now it's Russia. But in the time it was Prussia, which was Germany before Germany. Okay, basically Kaliningrad or Königsberg has a certain layout. So basically there's a river crossing the city, and the river basically forms two islands, and there are bridges connecting these two large islands in the middle of the city and the rest of the city. So there are seven bridges. So the problem that Leonhard Euler formulated was to devise a walk through the city that would cross each bridge once, with a constraint that the islands can only be reached by the bridges, and once you access a bridge, you cross it. Okay, it's not that complicated, and such a path doesn't exist. So he proved formally that this path doesn't exist, and that actually sparked a lot of interest in problems where you have what in mathematics they call vertices and edges, and what maybe engineers call nodes and links, right, that are connected, and it's all about identifying quicker ways to get from one place to another. Okay, traveler salesman problem, right, TSP. So a lot of work sparked actually out of this. So the river is called Pregel, by the way. So now networks are pretty much omnipresent. So I would say it's probably one of those concepts that are so successful that almost tell nothing now, because everything is a network. So they are so widespread that at some point it looks like you talk about all and nothing. So it was that big a success. So you do have social networks, companies, ecosystems, citation networks, like H-index, okay, that academics are so obsessed about is based on this. Right, citation networks, internet, of course, www, biochemical networks, communication networks, and so on and so forth, you name it, social networks. Okay. Now, curiosity about the World Wide Web, do you know who invented it? Probably yes. Not a computer scientist, not an engineer. Higher, louder. That's actually true, but where was he working? So the as far as I know, the World Wide Web actually started in CERN, the European Research Center for Nuclear Applications, right? So they basically needed a system to communicate between them. Okay, and then that actually gave rise to something much bigger, the World Wide Web. Okay, and the internet was actually a project from DARPA, the U.S. Defense Agency, Research Agency. It was very simple in the beginning. I think there were four nodes, right, connecting universities, and it was for military applications only, like in internal communications, and then it evolved into something else. So it's interesting actually that the traditional academic environment, it's normally not lending itself to very big discoveries. Okay, I'm a bit of a self-criticism here, because even information theory didn't come from a traditional academic environment. It was a company R&D lab. Lasers, likewise, transistors, likewise, optical fibers, I think same story, internet, World Wide Web, not the traditional university thing, at least. Okay, at best a research center, sometimes a company. So don't idealize too much your professors and your universities. You have to keep an open mind, okay? How do we use it for ICT? Okay, yeah, I mean, it has been studied, internet has been studied, so there is a paper from beginning of 2000 where they actually characterize the internet as a scale-free system, okay? And they show some interesting results. The paper is from Albert Barabasi. He's a professor from not MIT, another university in Boston. I think it's probably Northeastern University is called. Hmm? And he has a big lab working on this stuff. Internet definitely is, is it a purely technological network? Not too sure. Okay, the points are physical machines. The links are wires, sometimes wireless links. Interaction is electronic, but is it truly just technological? Okay, that's just open for your consideration. There is always, in technological networks, a big human component, right? So we might just be under the illusion that the network run by itself and has nothing to do with people, but in fact has a lot to do with people in the first place, okay? Now, the way you can analyze the network, the topology of a network, can include the size, so the number of nodes, the average degree, so how much each node is connected on average to other nodes, the average path length, so the number of steps it takes on average to get from one node to another, how far, in a sense, the nodes are between each other. And the clustering coefficient is basically, as we say, as the name says, a measure of clustering, but basically it tells you how much your neighbors are connected between them. So you are connected to these neighbors, and then if they are all connected in a full mesh network between themselves, this clustering coefficient of 1 or 100%. And if you have a star, the clustering coefficient would be 0, because none of the neighbors is connected with each other. They are just connected to the center of the star. Okay? So there are a few things. There are other things you can actually measure, and these are all coming from graph theory. One thing we have been doing is to analyze the topology of a network, but in the sense of functions. So we are actually working on this in, I didn't show results in this course, but we are doing some work in complexity, trying to map the functions of a telecom network to a graph, for example, frequency allocation, handover, whatever you want, and then calculate some form of neural complexity. And what we saw, for example, is that the correlation with these traditional graph theory metrics is very low. So there is something that complexity, and neural complexity specifically, is telling you that graph theory normally doesn't tell you. So it's no, we don't know exactly how useful this will be, but at least we know that gives you more, a different information than what graph theory metrics do. Okay. Now, the typical networks you can have are either regular, where you see there is a very regular structure of the interaction. Small world, you change basically the connectivity, and you go towards a situation where you increase the randomness in the network. So there is a model that can basically guide you in forming a small world network. And then random is when the probability of having a random connection to another node is 1. Random all the way. Now, a small world network is a network actually which is more or less in this region, right? Probabilities with the probability of random links is between 0 and 1, and you have a high clustering coefficient and a low average length. What does it mean? That these are networks that actually they might be interesting for us because they are networks which present clusters, as our networks do, and where it's relatively easy to transfer information between different parts of the network that are potentially even very far apart. Okay? Far apart in the physical sense, but they are, it's very quick in terms of number of links to reach them. Okay? So you could have, for example, that could have applications in the way you do coordinated multipoint, or you know, any transfer of information in our networks might actually be suitable to this analysis. Now there is a nice experiment which introduced the word small world, and it was actually done in the 60s. Okay, so basically what they did, there was a target individual in Boston, and it had to be reached by mail, by actual mail, not electronic mail at the time, right? So and the initial senders were in other states, and then each sender was just asked to forward the packet to a friend who was closer to the target. So you know, if you are in Nebraska and you have a friend which is who is closer to Boston than you are, you just ship the packet to that package to that person. And the friends were asked to do the same in turn. So eventually it turns out that it doesn't take too long, too much in terms of degrees of separation, and the average is 6. So it takes about 6 jumps before you reach destination. It's a bit impressive if you think about it. So it's not too much. Okay, so, and it was actually seen. I think I have the numbers here. Let me see. I think I have something about Facebook. Let's see if I find it. Made a PowerPoint. Um, I don't think I have it in this presentation. I think Facebook is about 4 to 5. So, but largely speaking, the numbers are small, okay? And that's where the world, the word small world comes from. When we say, you meet a person that you know from high school, you meet the person in Australia, okay? Ah, it's a small world. Now, that has become common jargon, but there is a scientific basis to that. And it appears that many networks are, in fact, following this kind of, what are you doing here paradigm, right? So, it looks like we are more connected to other people than we think. In fact, I was talking once with a friend, American friend, and it looked like the number of links to Obama was 4. So it's not, that it's impossible to reach out. Okay. The scale-free model was proposed by, there is a model actually based on preferential attachment, or what we call rich get richer, that can originate a scale-free network in an artificial way. So a new node would attach to, so there are two properties. One is growth. The networks tend to grow because of addition of nodes, and the nodes tend to attach to nodes that are already well connected. So that leads to situations which are sort of like the small world situation, right? Where you have clusters which are not that far apart. So it looks like that the networks that are working based on bottom-up approach, that are formed based on bottom-up approach, they are following this paradigm, because apparently it's an efficient way to convey information. So you have power law degree here. Internet, for example, is like that. No surprise, right? Because again, you are transferring information. So it's an efficient way to do it. So what we did actually was to adopt a model from statistical mechanics, which is a bit different approach. So it's more based on physics. So we did map some things like the energy into interference. And we did adopt like this spin up and spin down characteristics to the fact we map it to using a channel or not using it. And then if two neighbors use the same channel, we increase the sum, which means the interference goes up, okay? The degeneracy here in this context, at least related to what we discussed before, in this specific context, it simply means how many possibilities you have to have a certain energy / interference configuration. So the higher this number, it means that the more possibilities you have in terms of channel allocation to get a certain level of interference. So the higher this number it means as an engineer, the more degrees of freedom you have. You have to be less picky about interference. There are some algorithms that tell you how you actually scan a network. These are huge networks. Okay, here we are talking 500 nodes, and we are talking up to 5 channels. So the number of combinations is crazy. It's 5 to the 500, which is unbearable, okay, almost. So you need a very smart way to sample what we call the energy space, interference space, whatever space, because if not, you would never end, okay? If you just take a brute force approach where you just, okay, I'm trying all the combinations, yeah, you can do it for very small networks, very small combinations, combination numbers, but you cannot do it for the real networks we are dealing with. So the good thing about statistical mechanics is that it does provide a tool to sample large spaces. So that's very important for our networks as well. So there is a way where you can scan a state space in a representative way without losing too much information. Okay, there are some limitations, but it works. We just built an interference graph, very simple one, so we basically have the traditional definition of signal to interference ratio, signal to noise ratio, and then we decide that a base station interfere with another cell, a cell interfere with another cell if a certain portion of the users in the cell are feeling the interference from that base station, so no big deal. And then we did study what happens in terms of degree distribution, for example. So here, this theta is basically the interference threshold. So a higher theta means we are, in a sense, less picky or more aggressive, if you want. So we say 5%, it means that to say a certain cell is interfering my cell, I have to have at least 5% of the users in trouble. If I have 1%, it's more restrictive, right? Because I say that cell interferes my cell only if more than 1% of the users are in trouble. So the smaller theta, the more you're picky, you are more sensitive to interference, okay? And what we see, for example, is that, of course, becoming less picky is like you decrease the number of links, right? Because you feel less interference. So in terms of an interference graph, it's like you are feeling less, right? You define a link when there is interference. And if you, in a sense, become less restrictive about interference, you have fewer links, right? Is this clear, more or less? So of course you will have a higher probability to have lower connectivity, right? Now that's intuitive. Now the interesting thing though is that if you plot the number of configurations you have versus the interference, basically, first of all, increasing the threshold means you are actually decreasing the interference you feel. Again, no big surprise. You are defining your interference in a way that is less likely to happen, right? So you will have less interference in the network, no big deal. And another thing you can notice is that your, let's say, the number of, so these points are important, let's say these extreme left points, because they tell you the minimum interference, okay? This interference, so this will tell you how many configurations you have in terms of channel allocation that gives you the minimum interference. So the higher this value, the better it is. So the main message here is that if you become less picky, so more interference tolerant, you get many more configurations that suit you. Okay? And you see it also in terms of CDF. So the probability that the interference is below some value, okay, what happens here is that basically you see that the CDF translates towards the left. Let me think. What is the important message here? So, okay. So you have the probability that let's see for some notes here. Yeah, I don't think that tells too much, honestly, in terms of the CDF. It's more important the picture about the actual distribution. So the main message here is like if you define your network to be more interference tolerant by increasing the threshold, you know, based on which you define interference, you basically increase the configurations available for channel location quite a lot. Now, the interesting message here is that these CDFs are very steep. What does it mean? It means that if you focus on a probability to have a certain level of interference, which is say 10% or 90%, doesn't matter much, okay? So at this point, practically, it means that you will have more or less the same interference whether you have 10% of the possibilities available or 90%. So make it easy for yourself. Be a bit more interference tolerant, and you have a whole new world of channel allocation possibilities. Okay, so that's the main message. Now I understand I went quick. I didn't want to. I just wanted to give you a quick idea of the thing. I think, you know, again, the best approach to this is reading the papers, and you know, I can suggest you recommend you some resources. I hope at least it makes some sense, and it's some work we are doing. And one thing we will try to do. Definitely is to encompass the time dimension. I think it's very important to study the time evolution of this of networks in general, and there is a big space for research in that domain if you're interested. The final picture is not always as easy as it looks like. So graph theory can be very complicated. Okay, you might need sometimes to think about the problem you're modeling. Okay, I think we still have a few, like about quarter of an hour, so I would like to open up for discussion, comments, feedback, you know, very informal, don't think about the form now. So anybody that has something to say or curiosity, something you didn't know of, you know, whatever. Yes. Okay, the recording is over, so very freely you can say whatever you want. Okay. So, anybody wants to start?